experiment. We have never tried this particular program before, and it's just going to be interesting to see how this goes. We're going to videotape it tonight, hopefully be on Channel 4, so if you miss anything tonight, you can pick it up on Channel 4, we hope. And we tested this afternoon, and it does work, so if there's any technical problems, we've got some very good assistants back there, President Raymond and Jeff Angevine, so we've got two good technicians, so if everything goes according to Hoyle, we'll be all right. We have been collecting oral history for quite some time, and the Society has made major commitments to oral history and gathering information on tape. I've forgotten exactly how many tapes we have and how many oral history transcripts we have, but we have a great many upstairs. One of the problems, however, is that you never have enough of it, and you never know what questions to ask sometimes because you don't know what people are going to ask you. And when you're dealing with oral history, and local history particularly, which is a difficult thing to assess because much of local history is oral. And so one of the things that I have realized through the years as I've gone on, and here's almost 20 years now as director of the Society, there were so many people here in 1974 when I took over, I had all kinds of people to ask. But today we have it finding it increasingly difficult to find people who remember back when. And so it is a tough thing, and we know we need to collect as much as possible and emphasize oral history as much as possible. So we thought we'd try this out tonight, and maybe if it turns out to be successful, we will have it as an annual event, oral history, and see have different panelists every year and different questions and perhaps different topics. And we'll just see how this thing goes tonight. And so if there are any technical problems, we don't guarantee anything, but we'll do our best to get through this. And hopefully it'll work out all right. So we have tonight four panelists, and I'll introduce them in case you don't know them. Way over on my left here is Florence Hastings. She came to Bethel in the 1920s. She grew up in Bowdoin, Maine. Is that right? And she has lived here since the 1920s. So she has 60 years or so of recall. And of course, she had a very active husband who knew so much about history, and we taped him and we taped her. We taped both of them many times, and we know quite a bit about. But I'm sure things will come tonight that we haven't heard before. So Florence has about 60 years of recall in this area, and of course she has much more than that in the whole span of her life. We also are very pleased to have Olive Head here tonight. She told me that she made quite a sacrifice to come here tonight, so she wanted to remember that she did it for me. So I'm really appreciative of her. So we want to thank her for coming tonight. Olive, I think, grew up in Andover, and Olive and I share a common ancestor. Jeremiah Andrews was one of the first selectmen of Bethel, so we have that tie. And Olive would remember many things in Andover, but she'd also has lived in Bethel since the 1920s, and so she'd have a good 60, 70-year span of memories of Bethel. Of course, she also had a very interested husband, and he probably told her a lot of things about the local area that he knew. So I'm sure extended memory is going to go back quite a ways on this side. Over here, we have Grace Marl, who has lived in this area all her life and has been a stalwart, and she's going to be here tonight to share her memories. We also have Randall Stevens, who has lived in Bethel all his life and remembers a great deal. And Randall's one of the few people that we contact regularly to ask him about things because he has been here so long. But he's also one of the most cooperative people he is, and he has wonderful recall. So we'll see how this thing goes tonight and go from there. Okay, I had submitted questions to people to try to see what people might think, and I thought it might be good to ask a few of them and see what people have as memories back in the early days. And the first question we had on our list, maybe to start with Florence Hastings over here. Do you have any memories of your first day of school, Florence?
No, I can't remember that far back. I went to school, I know. But it was a rural school.
In Bowdoin?
In Bowdoin.
Yes. A one-room?
One-room school. And it had a stove in the middle of the room. And the teacher had graduated from high school.
I see. Did you all drink from the same dipper? That was one of the common things at school?
No, we didn't have any water at school.
Didn't have any water. and you probably had privies, did you?
Oh, yes, but it was far away.
Far away. And wood stove?
Wood stove. Yes. Mm-hmm. And long desk that three of us sat at.
I see. How many people were in the school?
Oh, about a dozen.
About a dozen. Okay.
And they didn't have school in the winter because there wasn't enough money.
I see.
So we had about less than 30 weeks of school.
I see. Olive, what was your first day of school like? Do you remember that?
Yes, I can remember my first day of school, and I was one of probably four or five children in the one grade. And I have an apple, the thing I remember about it, I had an apple left on my desk.
I see. Who did that, you know?
Yes, I know, but I'm not telling.
Grace, do you have a memory of the first day of school?
Yes, I do. Would you like to have me read it to you?
Oh, yes.
Shall I sit or stand?
You can stand, whatever you like. Stand right up. Go on.
First, I'll begin to let you all know where I come from. I was born and raised here in Bethel on July 4th, 1909. I grew up and went to and worked in Bethel and got married in Bethel and then went to Mason Township to live with Guy Morrow. So this is my first day of school. My mother told me to be good. Girl, I don't think she could trust me too much because I was quite a... Wouldn't say what. As she carried the children from the Hapgood farm, those were the Parson children and the Clough children for a few years. Ethel Philbrick Bisbee was my first school teacher, and this was her first year of school. Well, I never will forget it.
Okay, thank you. You were out in the Hapgood neighborhood, which would be out here on the Songapon Road, is that right?
Sir?
Out in the Hapgood neighborhood where the Songapon Road?
Yeah.
Okay, we just wanted to clarify that.
The old building still stands, big old farm building.
Yep, right. Okay, Randall, what about your first day of school?
I don't have any particular remembrance of my first day of school, but we lived about a mile from a middle little schoolhouse. We walked down across the field and pastures for 8 years to school, summer and winter. Didn't seem to notice the cold much in those days. we had running water in our school. You grabbed a pail and run across the road for a pail of water. In those times, people went to school to learn, it seemed so. And teachers was graduated Gould Academy 1 year, first year, and we figured they had the authority to handle things, and we didn't bother them much. I can't even remember being in anybody at school with a gun in their pocket.
You went to school in the middle of the school, which was across where Bob Marshall lived. Is that the school?
Yeah.
Which is now the was moved up on Bridge Street.
And yeah.
Was later. Okay, so that's the school you went to and attended.
Yeah.
Okay, let's move on then to the next question. What is your most vivid memory of school? Do you have a memory, Florence? A most vivid memory of school?
Yes.
That you can tell us?
Yeah. We had bad boys then, and two of the older boys had done something, and the truant officer came, and they went up overhead the schoolhouse, and there was a scuttle up overhead, and they wouldn't come down. And he told them that if they didn't come down, they'd be seeing white blackbirds. And that really impressed me. But they were the exception. They were the only two bad boys in the school, and they really were bad boys. One of them killed his wife, and the other one killed his brother.
I guess they were. Olive, what's your most vivid memory of school?
I think my best remembrance of school, of my school, was when I graduated. I was in the first class to have graduated from the what was then New High School.
New High School in Andover?
That's right.
I see.
And I was in the first class that graduated from there.
Great.
In 1920.
1920. Good.
That's right.
Good.
Thanks,
babe. Good. Grace, did you have a memory of your most vivid memory of school?
Oh, yes.
Going to school for my second year, we were going to have a Christmas tree. I went to school up here to this old brick schoolhouse.
The brick grammar school?
Yes.
Yes.
And though there was probably, I'd say, 25 children in each class, pretty near. So we were going to have a Christmas tree at school. And there came a big snowstorm and cold. There was no roads, so I asked my mother if I could walk. And my brother Pete Clough and I walked, so we stayed out with my great aunt Vera Holt overnight. So we live about 3 miles from Bethel on the Songopond Road.
Okay, thanks. Randall, what do you remember most vividly about school?
Well, not much. I guess I think our school was anywhere from 6 to 10. And I was, as far as I remember, I was the only one in my class any time.
You're the only one in your class?
Yeah.
Yes.
As far as I remember now.
I see. Were there much, was there much mischief activity?
I thought it was a pretty well-behaved school. I think they went more or less to learn something than did the raise an apple.
Who was the teacher?
Oh, he had a new one every year.
New one every year? I don't know what that sounded like before. Okay. We'll start over here, Randall. What's the coldest temperature you've ever seen in Bethel?
42.
42 below?
Below, yeah.
Yeah, when was that?
Oh, probably 50 years ago, I guess.
Yeah, 50 years ago or
somewhere
so, in the 1940s?
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah.
It was good.
What's the hottest temperature you've seen?
I can't remember about that, no.
Okay.
Didn't pay much attention to heat.
No. Grace, what's the hottest temperature you've seen?
Well, I can't remember the hottest one.
The coldest one?
The coldest one was this winter.
This winter?
It was 40 below zero one day this winter.
Yeah, it was 40 or 50 some places, yes, that's right. Olive, what do you remember about the temperature? What was the coldest day you remember?
I don't remember, but I go along with Grace, and I think this year was pretty cold.
Pretty cold? Okay. What's the hottest day you remember?
I have no idea.
No idea? Okay.
Probably I'd have to mention the 4th of July to be patriotic.
All right, okay. Florence, what do you remember about the weather?
I think this winter.
This winter was the coldest?
I think so.
Yeah? What's the hottest you remember?
Well, I don't remember, but I'd like to have another one just like it.
next question. What famous people have you seen in the Bethel area? Is there anybody sticks in your mind that we've seen or you've seen in Bethel or that might be of interest to people?
Well, I saw C.D. Howe.
Right.
And I don't remember of anyone else.
Okay.
I think that's about all.
Okay.
We live in East Bethel, and they probably didn't come to East Bethel.
No, that's probably true. Olive, did you have anybody, famous people that you remember coming to Bethel?
Yes, Margaret J. Smith.
Margaret J. Smith, okay.
And she had, evidently we were at a ladies' meeting, probably the Republican Party.
I see.
Somewhere.
I see.
And that I had the pleasure, after she was in Washington, to hear her give her maiden speech.
I see.
In, after her husband had died, and
I
she
see.
Replaced him.
I see. That would be 1940 or so, I guess, that she went to Congress. It's around 1940, I think, she went to Congress. Any famous people you remember, Grace?
Yes.
Okay.
The most famous man was William Bingham II. He done a lot for the people of Bethel. And as I was working at Bethel Inn, he gave me $500 as we got behind with our doctor and hospital bills. And look at what he has did for Gould's Academy.
What did you ever remember meeting him, did you?
Yes, I have.
You met him, yes.
I shook hands with him,
okay. So you...
Now, they done, working up to Bethel Inn years ago.
Yes.
And he used to come in there and eat dinner. So they see to it that the help shook hands with him to let him know that he had people waiting upon him.
I see. Good.
But then when he went for a ride here in his car, they pulled the shades down so he'd get down Church Street here, people wouldn't see him.
I see. Randall, do you remember any famous people in Bethel?
I remember Mr. Bingham, most of anybody. He hired a car and a man that owned the car to drive in places all the time. He'd come down to Collins Garage, if he made a squeak or anything, he'd fix it and try to. And twice a day, he went up to his place and he sat out by the front door and waited a while, see if he wanted to come out. If he didn't, he drove away. But he was supposed to be there twice a day on time, run and go. And I remember he used to come on the train and you'd look around on the track and there'd be a couple of cars on the siding down there. Nobody ever saw him get on or off, but sometimes he'd get off.
It was bringing a private railroad car, right?
Yeah, one or two cars.
Yeah, that's right. Well, that's good. Who do you think, Florence, was Bethel's most remarkable character, town character? Would you have anybody that you would think of right off?
No. I think they're all in the village.
Oh.
We didn't have any in East Bethel.
Paula, did you have anybody that you remember particularly well around Bethel that was kind of a town character?
No, I really don't.
No? No? Okay. Well, how about you, Grace? You must have somebody.
Well, come to think of it, the only man that I really can think of we used to have a lot of fun with, and that was old Frankie Bartlett at the foot of Mill Hill.
Right.
And a lot of carpentry work, and he kept the Bethel Inn wagons and sleighs all painted up nice. Well, every time we Clough kids would go down there and he'd be upstairs painting on the wagons, he would catch us and put a rub of paint over our faces. So we'd have to wash it off when we get home.
I see. That's good. Randall, do you have anybody that you remember as kind of a town character?
I think Guy Krauss.
Guy Krauss, yeah.
He was quite visible. We always see him going here and there. He wanted a man to dig a ditch for you, or give him a spade, he'd dig a good ditch for you. He worked pretty hard. I think he worked good on a job like that.
Yeah.
Remember after that, his sickness there, he went to Jigger Bound. Jigger Bound was his town road commission here for years and years, and he gave him a bush cutter in size, and they wanted more bushes. I don't know how many people have seen a bush size, but you keep away from them if you can. How the things get hold of. He worked a little while, looked around. He grabbed that bush side and threw it over the stone wall into the bushes, and he went home, and I don't think he ever did another day's work after that.
The guy was I can remember a guy was always shuffling around. He'd always tell you he walked to Berlin or some other places. He was really quite a character. That's
right. Yeah.
Oh, that was Herman Mason.
Okay, let's move on to the next question, which was, do you have any particular memories of the Great Depression in the 1930s? Randall, do you have any memories of the Great Depression that you want to share with us?
Well,
no, Randall.
Oh,
Randall.
We got along with the pretty good in the Depression season. In fact, I had a small farm and we had raised quite a lot of stuff. We took butter up to Bryant every week and then we'd hand him a slip of paper with names on it and he'd put your groceries up and hand it back to you and he'd give you credit for the butter you think that's in and he'd. The store was on the way down here by the bank, you know.
Well, the key bank is
packing lot,
yeah, yeah.
And then the next year we probably raised two pigs and had one for him and one for us. I never worked much less than $3 an hour, a day, I mean. And, we worked in the garage and the garage men were getting, the garage paying $1 an hour for the work. I remember one day, Marsh Hastings, he's one of the big holes, big loggers here, he offered to give us all his work if he'd give it away for 75 cents an hour. And we did for 75 cents an hour. But we wasn't just like the people in the city that didn't have enough to eat. We had plenty to eat and that kind of stuff. But the government didn't tell us how poor we was then in those days, you know.
Grace, did you have some memories of the Great Depression?
Oh, yes, I do. They allowed us 5 pounds of sugar per person a month, tea, coffee, and flour.
Was that Great Depression or World War II?
That was
the Great Depression? No. Sounds like World War II. You're talking about World War II. What about the Great Depression, the 1930s?
Yeah.
But what was it like during that period?
This was the Second World War.
I'm talking about 1930s, during the Great Depression.
Oh, Depression.
Depression. What, can you tell us something about that?
No,
absolutely. Do you don't remember how tough things were? Were things real tough in the...
Oh, yes, they were.
Yeah.
Well, I guess, wasn't that when they rationed our books?
No, that was the World War II period.
That was World War
II. World War II. We're talking about before that. The Great Depression, one of those tough times.
Well, I must have lived up the Mason.
Yeah?
Well, I'll tell you, if that was true, I probably lived up the Mason where we had all kinds of potato and vegetables and, I mean, vegetables and all kinds of, we had beef, you know.
Yeah,
we
beef.
Raised our own.
Right.
Our own meat.
So you didn't starve?
We didn't starve.
Didn't starve, okay. That's good enough. Okay. How about you, Olive, during the Great Depression? What were some of your memories during that period?
My memory of that drink was, money was really very hard at that time to get, and things were so hard to buy and so forth. But I think the main thing, as I remember, that we did to take care of ourselves was we learned to sew and make our own clothes and do as many things. Repaired, we made things do with what we had.
Yes.
But I do remember one thing in West Bethel at one time. This is hearsay, but I guess it's probably straight from my husband. He said that at one time during the Depression, there was only two cars in West Bethel registered.
Only two cars in West Bethel?
In West Bethel.
Yeah, in the 1930s. Oh. Interesting. Florence, any memories you have?
I don't think it had any bad effects on us at all.
Okay.
I've often heard Bob say that he didn't mind the Depression at all.
Okay, that's...
We had our own food, and it just didn't affect us.
You were one of the fortunate people then.
Yes, we were.
Yes, yeah.
We were very fortunate.
Yeah.
Yes, I remember. I remember now something.
Oh, you want to remember something? Okay.
They wanted Mr. Morrow, his father, to build a piece of road from the Meadow Bridge up to the top of that hill.
which isn't very much of a hill.
This is in Mason?
Is it? Oh, this was in Bethel.
Oh, Bethel? Okay.
So they hired Guy, my husband,
okay,
and Myron, with their horses and dump cart. And they had to get the dump cart license, which cost $2.
$2.
And they hauled the gravel all from our gravel pit, and put it over on that road and build that piece of road up through there.
Now, where was the road?
Well, it was right from the Meadow Bridge, you know,
Meadow,
where
Meadow, okay, Meadow Bridge, okay.
The east ramp,
yeah,
up to the top of the hills.
I see.
Up where Shirley and Buddy Clough has got their trailer home. It's
okay.
Just up that little small hill.
Okay.
And he got, Guy got $17 for doing it.
$17, how many days work?
Well, it was quite a few days
work. Quite a few days work, yeah, that's right.
So he said to me, he said, Grace, now, you take this $17, and he says, you go buy you a new winter coat, because I think you deserve it. So I got a new winter coat out of it.
Good. What memories do you have, any memories you have of World War One? You would have been about 12, 10
no,
hours.
No, I don't. No, I didn't.
No memories of World War One,
no.
Randall?
No.
No. Olive, you have any memories of World War One? You were quite young then.
Yes, I was. I was in high school.
You were in high school when the war? Do you have any memories of what anything happened during that war? That the war had an effect on you or your family or people you knew?
Yes, there were quite a few people in the area, in the West Bethel area, that we did know who went, was in the World War One.
Florence, you have any memories?
Well, food was rationed.
In World War One?
Yes, it was. And more so than in World War Two.
It was tougher in World War Two, you think, than World War One than World War Two?
Yes, I think, yes. We had less.
Yeah, we had less.
We had less, and that's the only thing I remember about it.
Okay. Grace, do you remember anything about World War One?
Well,
you've been fairly young.
I was too young.
Yeah. Okay, let's move on to World War Two. Randall, do you remember anything about World War Two that was what Bethel was like, or something about the...
Well, I remember the principal thing I can remember about was the airplane watch. We had to learn the different kind of airplanes, and we had to watch 24 hours a day, 2 or 3 years, for airplanes coming.
Were you part of the Home Guard, were you?
No, I wasn't on the Guard.
No.
I was just the people putting on it there.
Yeah.
And I remember I usually stayed from 9 till 12, once or twice a week, I guess. And we had a place up on Paradise there where we stayed. And I remember one afternoon I was on duty in an old B-17 from right over Fowl Mountain there. That thing looked pretty big to me. And then the corporation, you had a tire that blowed out, and you couldn't fix it, you could go see somebody and they'd give you a tag or something, either me be an old bald-headed tire probably, but some folks might have new ones. And then rationing for meat and sugar and that stuff. You had a book and a stamp a week, and you'd have so much every week of that.
Well, you think ration really was tough on people, was it? Or do you think?
You didn't do much running around. You had to stay home, plenty of home. You couldn't drive a car very far. No, you couldn't get much meat.
Because people said there was a great black market in World War Two.
There was a black market.
The one here in Bethel, I understand, as well as everywhere else. And,
it was a black market, all right.
Yeah. Depending on who you knew, right?
Yeah, helped a little.
Yeah, yeah.
You could follow the fella. I know, probably you could go down and buy meat and anything you wanted, you know, of him.
Yeah.
At the old store, you couldn't buy a very big amount.
No.
No.
But I was also told you could get gas if you know the right person.
Well, these people, the farmers, had tractors, allowed extra gas because they wanted to raise what they could, you know.
Yeah.
If they had an old tractor off in the corner somewhere, didn't run tall, they'd get a big book of stamps to go with it.
Okay.
Do something that way.
Yeah. Grace, do you have some memories of World War II?
Yes. Well, sugar and flour and butter was rationed.
you couldn't go here in town and buy a pound of ballot unless you had these tickets. And these.
But if you raised your own, though, if you raised your own ballot, you could have as much as you
want. Yes, I did.
Yeah.
And I cheated.
Yeah.
And I sold some of my ballot for $2 a pound. But you couldn't buy a pound of ballot here in Bethel, you know. Yeah. It was so hard. So I cheated. And Guy, he always liked to make fudge once a week. So in order for him to make the fudge, I gave him my sugar, because I didn't care much for sugar sweets. So, and to this day, I don't eat much sugar, so.
So the sugar, lack of sugar didn't bother you that much in World War II? No.
Sugar was terrible. You couldn't have to get enough to make a cake.
Yeah, okay, that's good to know. Olive, any memories of World War II?
Yes, I can remember the stories of the things that happened during the sugar ration. But my older sons were all delighted when they had a little sister, so they had one more ration.
I see. Florence, anything you remember about
World War II? Yes, you couldn't buy a car, and you had to get permission to buy a piece of farm equipment. Gasoline was rationed. Everything, just about everything was.
Okay. Any other memories that you have of the war period? The war's effect on people? Anything more?
Well, I remember people not wanting to go to war. Mm-hmm. Farmers didn't have to go. They could get out. A lot of people became farmers.
The farmers didn't starve.
No. Okay, let's move on to the next question. Do you remember where you heard the news, what you were doing with the news of Pearl Harbor, Randall?
It's about supper time on the radio, yeah. Heard it. Couldn't hardly believe it, but it was all so, I guess.
Yeah, it was quite a blow to people.
Well, I guess it was. Quite.
Grace, do you have some memories of Pearl Harbor?
Well, all I remember, we heard it on the radio. But, of course, we lost one awful nice boy in town, Stanley Allen.
Stanley Allen, that's right. Olive, what do you remember about Pearl Harbor?
Yes, I remember Paul and I and some of the family were in Andover visiting friends, and they had just heard it on TV that afternoon.
On the radio.
On the radio, I should say.
Yeah, yeah.
At that time, and we were all shocked, of course, at that.
Florence, what do you remember when you heard
Pearl Harbor? No, I just remember hearing it on the radio, because we were all shocked. That's all I remember.
Okay. What do you recall about the hurricane of 38, Randall? What do you recall about that?
I don't know. That's one that we planned to go down to the seacoast and see Catherine, so that's where we decided. Get down to, may not be the one, I don't know. We get down to Lewiston and there's trees was down and lights was out and we couldn't get down to the ocean and we had to come back. That might have been the one, I don't know.
It blew down a lot of timber.
Yeah, a lot of trees in the city there blew down. Yeah, a lot of timber, yeah.
Grace, you remember the hurricane of 38?
Yes, I was working at the Hanover Dowell Mill and Mr. Poor, that used to live up the street here, he came and told us that his wife had heard that we were going to have the hurricane. So I left and went to the grain mill for a few bags of grain, which that was my duty I had to do. Never go home without a bag of grain. And to the store to pick up a few groceries. And then when I got home, I went out in the summer kitchen and put a board across the door and nailed it with some board nails. So I guess the hurricane took off in another direction.
Olive, you remember the hurricane of 38?
Oh yes, I remember it very.
What, can you describe what it was like during that period? Did it, was a lot of wind and rain?
Oh yes, yeah. Wind and rain. I had washing out on my upstairs line and I went out in the middle of the night, got that in, for it blew away.
I see. Did it happen at night here?
Yes, I went out during the night because I thought that washing needed to be taken in, or I might have been in Bethel by morning.
Yes. Florence, you
Well, I remember late in the afternoon, it blew one of the outside doors open, and a lot of trees blew over.
Really, yeah?
It was a real scary time.
And I guess a lot of logging had to be done right after that because they were cutting trees for quite a while after the Hurricane 38.
There's a lot of damage in the woods.
Yeah. Let's move on then to our favorite flood. Olive, you remember the flood of 36?
Yes, I do.
What's your vivid memory of that?
Mine, of course, is more or less, I'm usually post office inclined.
Right.
Letters and so on and so forth. But the mail wasn't getting through. Steam mill was flooded.
Uh-huh.
And after, I believe it was 2 days, we had no mail. And finally, they got some through. But of course, the trains weren't going. It wasn't raining at that time. But somebody, one of the postmistresses in Bethel, called and told Paul if he would get somebody and come down, walk the railroad track to down to the steam mill. Somebody would come up with a boat and bring the first class mail. And so Paul and I took some 4 people along with him, and they walked the railroad track.
And got the mail down the steam.
The first class mail.
First class mail, right, yes. Right. Good. That's good to know. Florence, any memories of the flood of 36?
Yes, the river came up to the foot of, it came up to the road.
East Bethel Road, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
And your grandfather and Bob and Bill took a canoe and went to the store.
Down to Maggie Newton's store.
Went to Maggie Newton's store in a canoe.
That's good. Didn't they also try to keep the potatoes from getting wet?
Yes.
In this potato house over there?
Yes. Yeah. But I think they did get wet.
They did get wet, yeah.
Yes.
It got so high.
Mm-hmm.
Grace, what do you remember about the flood of 36?
Well, I lived up in Mason, and we had a very bad flood. And, well, I lived there till I was 65 years old until I got hard of hearing. Then I had to move down to Bethel. But we had a terrible flood.
Terrible.
And if we could go all over those big intervals with boats.
Yeah, yeah. Randall?
Well, I was in that flood. Remember that? That was the last of January, February, I guess. Had about 3 feet of snow. It rained 3 days and the ice went out. And you could see all the trees, 10 feet high, where I went when the ice went out, hit all the trees and scratched them all the way down through. Well, I lived down that Saladin's place, and they could see the water creeping up across the fields there. So we started canning potatoes upstairs. We had to take them up, one flight of stairs and through. We got some fellows to help us, and they run across. I'm homebrew there. I don't know what I'm talking about homebrew. Walter Ballantyne had the last bag of potatoes, and he got just the top stairs, and he dropped the bag of potatoes, and he rolled right over and over and over, right down the stairs and across the living room floor, just as perfect as it could be. Well, So we went and got the boat down there first, so we didn't want to leave us, had to. And we jacked up everything, the piano and lugged stuff upstairs. And when the water got higher, we took a boat around the front of the house, and along about 9, 10 o'clock, come right up through the floor. Water poured right up through all over the place. And, well, Charles even crawled up on the porch. On the couch there, I'm going to stay right here, I said. Well, we walked around there doing what we could, and water got about 6 inches deep pretty quick. And, well, just guess we're going to get in the boat and go home now. He climbed right down off the pier into the boat. We rolled up the road till we struck ground, and then stayed at my father's place there.
Well, I don't think we can get out of Mason for a week after
after the flood, no.
I think these houses are that I have water in them for two or three weeks. We were in hours, probably a few hours, and there wasn't a corner and anywhere in the closet or anything that didn't have sand in it. It was 3 feet deep in the house.
Three feet deep, yeah.
And when we went down this morning, it was all gone away. I think it was ice jam, probably, then, jammed up, probably. And it's bad enough, deep enough.
Okay, let's move on then. Another question is, what's your most vivid memory of your childhood, Florence? You have a very vivid memory?
Well, my father had a Stanley steamer and it blew up. I remember that.
Yeah, that must have been very good. Did it do any damage to anybody?
It burnt my mother's coat, and she was unhappy about that.
I can imagine. That is quite a vivid memory. Olive, what's your most vivid memory of as a child?
I seem to remember all of the parades and things that we had for every, like 4th of July and so forth. Out was the parades, and at memorial time, everybody gathered their flowers and marched to the cemetery with their flowers. All the school children made up, that was part of the memorial to us, to march from the school building down to the to the cemetery with our flowers.
Good. Grace, what's your most vivid memory?
Well, I always liked to go down to the Hapgood farm. It was a big farm.
Hapgood farm over the Song of Pond Road?
Yeah. They kept a lot of cattle. And the Parsons, this was George Hapgood's daughter. She lost her husband, so she brought her five children to come up there at the farm to live. So they were just Wycliffe's children's age, you know. So we had a great time playing with them. Then I also liked to go to my Uncle Miller Clough's house. He lived down in Albany then.
Yes.
To play and stay with Maxine Clough Brown. Did that a lot.
Good.
That's what I had a good time then.
Okay, good. Randall, what's your most vivid memory as a child?
Well, I remember my father always get up in the morning and built the fire and went out to the barn. When he come back, breakfast was ready. Rolled oats usually and the potato warmed up in old hog fat. And us boys was up, dressed, and ready to eat when the rest was, always, to the ready to go to the table. Didn't hang back or anything like that. We done, made the most of our own toys. We made a double run of bobsled apiece. I made a pair of skis, cut a tree and made a pair of skis. And we had a tree house. And we had quite a pipes we made there. And so went down, borrowed my mother's meat grinder and ground up some pine needles. And she says, I like nobody else that meat grinder. Don't cut very good lately. And there was one day we didn't have much to do. We're getting kind of out of material. We thought we'd dig up old Bill up on the hill there and see if we couldn't get some bones to make some calves off and stuff like that.
That was the horse?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Cadillacs and all kinds of cars are made out of him. When I was 12 years old, my father says, you think you can drive those horses and mow? And I says, probably. So he made a swath around the field and handed me the reins. And I mowed that field. And I did quite a lot of mowing that year after that.
Good. You got a memory of your adult years that you remember most? Your most vivid memory of your adult years, Florence? What's your most vivid memory of your adult years?
Well, I don't know. I went to high school in Brunswick and Bodenham, and I walked 2.5 miles. We didn't have a bus to take us. And, well, they weren't very exciting years because I lived so far out, I didn't take part in anything.
How about your later life? Did you have anything you remember particularly about your later life after you were married?
How late?
Well, how late? What about how late you want to say? Anything else, anything you remember about your life as an adult that you, vivid memory?
No, not anything in particular.
No.
I came to this area 70 years ago, and the mountains impressed me. I didn't know how we were going to get around them.
Yeah.
When, once we lived near the ocean. And, we didn't have the things then that we have now. There was one bathroom in East Bethel, no electric lights. And our social life was the Grange and the Extension Service, because we had no television. Later we had radio.
Yeah.
Well, it wasn't too exciting.
Olive, any vivid memories of...
Well, I'll begin with that. Florence and I graduated both from normal school from Gorham. We were not in the same class, but we were both there at the same time, so it was a pleasure to be here tonight. And we have been talking, reminiscing about our Gorham days.
Gorham days, I see. Good, good. Grace, any vivid memories of your adult years?
Not till now. Had some good times.
Good times, okay. You're not going to elaborate, huh? Randall, what anything you remember vividly as
well,
an adult?
I always remember that I started building my house in 1939. Nails was, like 100 pound nail, a keg of nails was $4.50. I bought a good many kegs.
Yeah.
Some difference is now. Remember that?
Sure is. Maybe now we could turn to the audience and see if anybody in the audience has any questions of our panelists or anything they want to bring up at this time. Any questions in the audience?
Where did Randall live when the water was so deep in his house? Where was your house then?
Down on the South Eden Place, down in the middle interval.
Where the ferry was.
Where the ferry used to be.
Yeah, Kendall's Ferry crossed. Where the Winslows lived later, I think. Was that the Winslow place?
Yeah, Winslow lived later. Yeah. They had a car ferry one mile, and they just had a ferry for a person to go across.
Yeah.
It was, I think, must have jammed up there. The river, the Sunday River runs in down there, and the narrows up there, probably. Because it came up awful fast.
Other questions from the audience? Any more questions? Yes, Nan?
I was kind of curious to know how old you were when you started school.
About 5. And I started high school when I was 12. Mm-hmm. We went ahead as fast as the teacher thought we should. We didn't have grades.
Was that the same in Bethel, Mrs. Head?
I wasn't in Bethel. I was in Andover at that time. Yeah. But I was in a four-room building at that time.
But did you start when you were as young as 5?
I think I was 5, probably.
How about you, Grace? How old were you when you started school?
I think I was 5.
5? Yeah. And Randall?
I don't remember, sure. See, Richard was... he was 2.5 years younger than they... I stayed back a little bit, so she was 1 year behind me in school. I don't know what time I sat in.
Hubert.
Yeah. Okay, other questions from the audience? Anybody got any other questions they want to know? Our comments from the audience? Yeah, Nan?
Our little wings, Randall, said AWS on them, Air Warning Service.
Did what?
During World War II, that was one of the little things that my mother made me do too.
Do what?
Watch for airplanes.
Watch for airplanes.
Oh, yeah. And we set up a whole crew, somebody was supposed to watch 24 hours a day.
Yeah. Observers at the.
And call in quick if anybody calls up.
There was one place on Paradise, and also one down on the Buck Place, wasn't it?
Yeah, both places.
Yeah, during World War II.
Yeah.
Yes.
During World War II, I think it must have been the government or somebody sent my husband a
paper and wanted him to go up to the church and board the church windows off. So he and his brother, Myron Morrow, they went up and boarded up the church windows. Now, I don't know what that amounted to. But okay. He got a certificate for doing it, so I still have it.
I see.
What church was that, Greg?
The Mason Church?
Mason Church.
Mason Church.
Oh, yes, they come and tore it down and hauled it off way down. He'd build up a seven-day Advent church out of it.
Any other questions of the panel? Or any comments, or Mother?
I wondered, Randall, remember some of the teachers' names in Middle Edinburgh?
The teachers of Middle Edinburgh, Randall. Who were the teachers of Middle Edinburgh you had for teachers? Who were the people who had as teachers?
We had a fresh teacher every year from Gould Academy. After they graduated from Gould Academy, they taught in our school because it was one very important.
Any names that you remember?
Oh, both Wilson girls.
Minnie?
Taught there. Minnie and Myrtle Bott taught
Minnie
down
Myrtle.
There. Yeah. That's the first school they put them into, I guess, after they graduated from Gould Academy.
The school had a normal program, they called it.
Well, sort of, yeah. Afterwards, they had to go to normal school a while, but
yes.
They didn't leave there. No.
Any other questions from the audience? Yes?
I understand around Bethel they have a lot of bootlegging going on. Does anybody have any comments on that?
During Prohibition?
Yeah.
That's what?
No. Any memories of during the Prohibition era, any bootlegging that you remember, Florence?
Yes, we had some in East Bethel. a man had built a house. And he built a basement underneath, and he had made his liquor under the house. And the police would come and search the place, and they'd dig in the ground, and he'd get a shovel and help them dig, and very cooperative. But finally, someone told on him, and they went into a bedroom and took up a linoleum on the floor and kicked the bed up against the wall and went down and found where he was making his bootleg.
Who was it?
Who was it? I don't remember.
Prohibition, what it was like during that period?
No, I really don't remember anything about that. No. But I have a question to ask. Why did Paul have to go to the steam mill to meet the boat? Because the railroad, the train evidently wasn't going through, couldn't get through. How long were we without a train?
Does anyone remember how long we were without a train in 1936 during the flood? Does anybody know how long it took the train to get through?
You see, the steam mill was all closed.
The steam mill was closed. Don, do you remember something?
The grade of the railroad back of the Larch Mills Church was just washed right out. And so that prohibited the train from coming there. But I don't know for sure what that was.
Yeah.
I thought it was. Was that 36?
36, okay. Avery says 36.
The train from coming any farther than Larch Mills.
Yeah, well, they must have got something up to get somehow. Somehow they got up here to Bethel to get the mail to.
Well, I think you'll find that Leslie Davis, people like that, took boats down.
Took boats, okay. Came by boats rather than by rail. So you think
well,
it came.
From Larch Mills up.
Yeah, from Larch Mills up, okay. Any other. Oh, you want. How about you on bootlegging? Anything that you.
No. My husband was anything like that.
Yeah,
so
was
I, too.
Yeah, okay.
I remember.
Randall?
Remember a lot of bootleggers come down through Grafton Arch. They got that direct route to Canada, of course. And we had one car there. He couldn't go, and Connor tried to get gas out of it, and he couldn't do anything about it. And finally found the gas tank was full of drills. They couldn't buy drills, you know, for drilling iron. Had the gas tank right full of drills. And I had quite a job getting gas out through that thing. Got rusty in it and everything. Just have trouble with them cars sometimes down there, coming down through.
No liquor in my family.
No liquor in your family? Okay. any other questions from the audience? Does anybody have any on the panel have anything further to say? Any more final comments? Maybe you have a philosophy of how you lived as long as you have. Lawrence, you got a philosophy of how you might have quite lived as long as you have?
I have no idea. I guess it's my genes.
Genes? Both your parents lived to be in their 80s?
Yes, and my grandmother 100.
100? Okay. That's a good sign. Mm-hmm. Olive, do you have any idea why you lived to be 90?
I guess perhaps just from where year to year, I just lived on and on. Did try to take care of myself.
Good.
Watch my health.
Good.
Olive, tell them how old Effie was.
My sister was 98 when she passed on. And I have a sister-in-law who is 99, and in May will be 100.
Oh, good.
So you see, I come from a long life family, although my mother and father both died in their 80s.
80s, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. That's old for that period, though.
That's right.
Yeah. Any philosophy from you, Grace, is how you've lived as long as you have?
No.
Why have you lived as long as you have? You don't have any idea why you're
not? No, because I've lived good.
Lived good, I see.
I don't drink or smoke.
Okay. Randall, how come you live as long as you have?
You want to just keep right on doing what you're doing and not slow down the more you have to.
Yeah.
They claim you ought to have a drink a day, but I think that's too much, but a little don't get you anything.
I'm doing more I have to do than you.
Any other comments or questions from the audience?
Yeah, one more comment?
Okay.
This was question 12 on your paper.
Question 12, we have a question 12. Oh, under what's describing what circumstances you saw your first auto, or radio or television?
This was Mr. Herrick, must have been Barbara's grandfather. He built he had an old Model T Ford, and he put some skis in the front of it.
The snowboat?
Yeah, snowboat. And so he used to go calling around on that. And he took, I was probably 18 years old, I just remember it. And so he used to take Dr. Tibbetts around the doctor. Tibbetts to call on his patients, so he came out to our house for a call, and so we kids was all excited, you know, to see those skis on that car and see it go.
Good. Any other comments, questions? I think we've had a good cross-section of experiences here, and maybe we'll see what we'll do about this program, but I think I've certainly enjoyed it, and I hope all you have. Thank you for coming. Thanks.